Hello everyone. In this video, I'll provide an overview of ASIC design flow used in VLSI technology. Let's get started. What is VLSI? VLSI stands for Very Large Scale Integration. It is a process technology where thousands to millions of transistors, both NMOS and PMOS, are integrated onto a single chip to form an integrated circuit or IC. This technology is the backbone of modern electronics, enabling the compact, high-performance devices we rely on every day. From microprocessors to memory chips, VLSI has revolutionized computing, communication, and everyday technology. VLSI technology enables IC design using two primary design flows: ASIC, application-specific integrated circuit flow, and FPGA, field programmable gate array-based flow. ICs developed in ASIC flow are custom designed and tailored for a specific task or application. They offer high performance, power efficiency, and optimized area utilization, but they require longer development cycles. Examples of these ICs are consumer electronics used in smartphones, smart TVs, and game consoles for graphics rendering, audio processing, and cellular communication. Another daily life example is telecommunication and networking ICs used in routers, switches, and modems optimized for high-speed data processing. Now, the FPGA flow. In this flow, ICs are pre-manufactured and available in market, which can be configured by users to perform specific logic functions. These ICs contain hundreds of thousands of logic blocks and interconnects, which can be programmed using hardware description languages to implement complex digital circuits. FPGA ICs provide flexibility and faster prototyping, making them ideal for a proof of concept development before committing to an ASIC design. However, the faster time to market is obtained at the cost of higher power consumption and lower optimization. Now, let's look at the different steps in ASIC design flow. In ASIC design flow, a custom IC is developed for a specific task. Here is a high-level overview of the ASIC design process. The very first step in ASIC design is ideation and specification development for an IC intended for a particular application. This process includes defining system requirements, including functionality, performance targets, power limits, and constraints. The next step includes design and verification. In the design and coding stage, first, the system specifications are converted into a high-level architecture, and then this architecture is developed into a register transfer level logic using hardware description languages, for example, Verilog and VHDL. This HDL model is then converted to a gate level netlist, which is an ASCII file containing AND, OR, etc. logic gates and memories. This netlist is then optimized for area, power, and performance. And finally, the layout, that is an ASCII 3D silicon representation of the design, is created for the gate level netlist. After each step during the design process, it is critical to ensure that the design meets the system requirements and it is free of errors. It is achieved by simulating the design using test vectors and verifying it for correct functionality, timing, power at every step. If any issue is found, RTL is updated to fix the issue and the design is verified again. After a detailed verification and a final sign-off, the design is sent to the semiconductor foundry for fabrication, for example, to TSMC or an Intel fab. These foundries manufacture and package the IC. Finally, the fabricated chip is tested in lab to make sure it meets the specified performance and power requirements. Now let's look at the FPGA design flow. In the FPGA design flow, the intended chip specifications are implemented using hardware description languages such as Verilog and VHDL. The design is then synthesized into a netlist, verified, and finally programmed onto a pre-built FPGA to achieve the desired functionality. Unlike ASIC design, this design process does not include creating custom ICs, but instead configures an existing hardware to meet specific requirements. Let's discuss further about the ASIC design flow. Here is a chart that illustrates the key stages of the ASIC design process. This process spans from defining specifications to generating a GDS2 file, which is the key information that is sent to IC manufacturers for fabrication. The different stages are to develop chip specification, algorithm design in C or C++, architecture design, RTL design using Verilog or VHDL, RTL verification, RTL synthesis or logical synthesis to get gate level schematic netlist, verification of gate level netlist, floor planning, placement and routing to obtain a layout, post layout verification and sign-off checks, generation of a GDS2 file and sending it to fab. This structured approach ensures optimized performance, power and area efficiency before manufacturing a final IC. Let's go over these steps in detail. The first steps involve gathering input from stakeholders and translating chip specification into detailed technical requirements. Key aspects of the chip include defining expected outputs, performance objectives, and power consumption targets. It is important to ensure compliance with industry standards. In this stage, we also establish a behavioral description that outlines functionality and performance of the chip. A well-defined specification serves as a foundation for the entire design process, ensuring clarity and alignment with project goals. In the next step, the chip functionality and algorithm is implemented using a high-level language such as C or C++. This allows for an early functional validation of the design, performance evaluation before the hardware implementation, and development of a proof of concept to ensure feasibility of the final product. This step helps identify potential design issues early, reducing the risk in the later stages of the ASIC development process. Once the specifications and proof of concept are established, the ASIC architecture is designed. We define high-level and low-level architecture design details. High-level design details include defining the overall structure, functional block arrangement, clock frequencies, power and performance targets, and data flow within the chip. For low-level details, we specify modules, state machines, counters, registers, and interconnections between the block. ASIC designers evaluate multiple design approaches, balancing performance, feasibility, and hardware resources while ensuring cost efficiency within the budget constraints. Here is a high-level architecture of a microprocessor, for example. Once the architecture is defined, designers implement the ASIC functionality using register transfer level design, typically in hardware description languages such as Verilog or VHDL. These RTL descriptions are written as ASCII files and represent the logic of the design. This phase bridges the gap between abstract architectural design and the physical design implementation. It ensures that the design logic is accurately captured and suitable for synthesis. The RTL defines how data moves between the registers and how operations are performed on that data. Not all the blocks in RTL are written from scratch. Many blocks, especially common functionalities, for example, logic gates, flip-flops, or memory elements, can be reused from previous designs. This reuse reduces the design time and improves reliability as these blocks have already been verified in prior implementations. Here is the Verilog code for a simple single-port RAM block commonly used in different architectures. Once the RTL is implemented, it is verified. Functional verification ensures that the ASIC design behaves correctly and meets the specified requirements by testing and simulating the RTL code on a test bench. This stage is crucial for identifying and fixing design flaws before synthesis. Industry standard tools, for example, QuestaSim and VCS from Synopsys, are used to simulate the RTL behavior, validate logic functionality, and ensure compliance with the design specifications. If any issues are discovered during functional verification, the design team will return to the RTL code and fix it accordingly. The next step is RTL synthesis or logical synthesis. In this step, designers convert the RTL code into a gate-level schematic netlist by mapping it to target technology libraries provided by TSMC or other vendors. These libraries contain fundamental building blocks like logic gates or cells, for example, NAND, NOR, AND, OR, flip-flops, latches, and memory elements, along with timing, power, and area data for each of the cells. The synthesis process ensures that the RTL design is correctly implemented in terms of logic gates and memory components while optimizing power, performance, and area. Primarily, tools from Synopsys and Cadence are used to generate gate-level netlist. This gate-level netlist serves as a basis for the next stage of ASIC design, that is physical design and layout generation. Once the gate-level netlist is generated, the design undergoes verification to ensure it meets the specified functionality, timing, and power constraints. This involves simulating the gate-level representation using a test bench to validate correct behavior under real-world conditions. Key aspects of gate-level verification include functional verification to ensure logical correctness after synthesis, timing analysis for checking up setup and hold time and finding timing violations, power analysis to evaluate dynamic and static power consumption of the design. Industry tools such as Synopsys VCS and PrimeTime are commonly used for this stage. In modern complex chips, increasing on-chip variations require a thorough validation. To address this, design for testability or DFT techniques are integrated after synthesis to ensure robust testing under these variations. Once timing and power constraints are met in the schematic netlist, the design proceeds to layout stage. Designers use various techniques to optimize the placement and routing of functional blocks within the chip layout. This optimization enhances performance, power efficiency, and area utilization. The key steps in this process include floor planning, placement, and routing. Floor planning is the process of arranging and placing functional blocks within the chip layout to optimize power, performance, and area. This stage defines the chip's layout by determining optimal placement of major blocks, positioning input-output pins for optimal connectivity and efficient power routing while minimizing voltage drops and signal interference. Tools such as Cadence Virtuoso and Synopsys IC Compiler are used for floor planning. Placement is the process of arranging standard cells, for example, logic gates and flip-flops, into rows on the chip. A poor placement can lead to a larger chip area and degrade the overall performance of the IC. So there are several factors that must be considered during placement. For example, minimizing wire length to reduce delays and power consumption, and efficient placement to optimize the power usage and heat distribution. Routing is the step where connections between the placed cells are made, typically using metal layers. This step also ensures that the clock signal reaches to all the components in a balanced way, minimizing skew and delays. Once placement and routing are completed, a GDS2 file is generated. This file represents the final physical layout of the chip. The design then undergoes another round of verification and final sign-off checks. There are three main sign-off checks to ensure the design is correct and ready for manufacturing. These checks confirm that the layout meets all specified design rules and functions as intended before being sent to foundry for fabrication. The first check is layout versus schematic. This check ensures that the geometry or the layout matches the schematic netlist, confirming the final physical design matches the intended logical design. In design rule check, we ensure that the geometry in the GDS file meets the design rules set by the foundry. These rules include spacing, width, and layer constraints that must be followed to ensure proper manufacturing. In logical equivalence check, we ensure that the pre-layout and the post-layout designs are logically equivalent, confirming that no functional errors have been introduced during the design process. At the end, a final timing check on the design ensures that all constraints are met by adjusting parameters, adding buffers, or refining critical path for optimal performance. After successful verification and timing closure, the design is considered ready for tape-out and fabrication. After the final GDS2 file is generated and verified, it is sent to semiconductor foundry for fabrication. The foundry uses this GDS file to create a physical silicon chip through a series of processes, for example, mask creation, wafer fabrication, and packaging. Once the chip is fabricated and packaged, it undergoes post-silicon testing in lab before it can be widely marketed. This stage is crucial for ensuring the functionality, performance, and reliability of the chip in real-world conditions. The lab testing includes functional testing, which ensures that the chip performs its intended functions correctly. Performance testing to check if the chip meets the expected speed, power, and timing requirements. A stress testing, evaluating the chip under extreme conditions to ensure it can handle real-world use cases. Any issues discovered during post-silicon validation are addressed through design adjustment, firmware updates, or both. Only when the chip passes this validation phase, it is considered ready for production or market deployment. So this was an overview of the ASIC design flow used in VLSI technology for manufacturing efficient ICs for different applications. I hope you find this video helpful.